All right, peace and blessings. Sapo, the Honorable One, Haki Shakur, Ammi here. Thank you for tuning in, listening in. Oh, man, I want to do this piece. Had a powerful event last night. That's right, the Success Scholar was in the house moderating the decade. The debate of the decade. And got a nice watch there, flam. So I just want to call this the debate of the decade, and Daren Muhammad and none of the other Baltimore Bammers can shine the shoes of Malik Zulu Shabazz. It never ceases to amaze me just how people need, feel so insecure in their own leadership that they have to create these false narratives into the minds of the ignorant, non-thinking, shall I say, follower type of mindset that many individuals have. And so I'll just share exactly what happened and why I just recognized that Daren Muhammad and some of these other no-show people, you know, these missing in action folk who, particularly David Johnson, who particularly attempted to denounce or discourage attendance from the debate of the decade of Dr. Cornel West, who many of them can't touch his shoes, and whether we agree fully on every particular issue that he has to offer, you know, people put themselves in these little divisive little camps to create these type of divisions within, you know, the movement. And so what I'm saying is that, you know, for the sake of unity, sometimes we have to work with different people that have different views and opinions that we are oriented towards. And this is where we have to move towards becoming a success scholar. And that's what I'm attempting to do with this video, is to act as a bridge. And let me just drop why it's actually hypocritical for persons like Daren Muhammad to make statements that that Malik is taking LGBT money. And if Irritated Genie feels the same way, he's entitled to his unique, narrow views and opinions. But that's no basis in reality. I can certainly attest that wouldn't nobody give Brother Malik Zulu Shabazz any money for anything. I mean, you know, he doesn't need any handouts from anybody because he's an independent brother. He's not desperate and destitute. He didn't go around making 10,000 babies. And fortunately enough, he has enough skill and intelligence to maintain his economic viability. Not everybody has enough sense, you know, when they have a family, to not jeopardize their livelihood. So he certainly has maintained, a level of independence while serving our community, while creating employment for our people, keeping our people off the streets from committing homicides and suicides and robberies and committing other criminal activities, people that could be doing these things. So, you know, that's where, you know, it is very narrow and shallow for people to take these small cheap shots on a brother that has laid out the work. But what I will say is I informed Brother Malik of these things, and, you know, I don't want to be instigator of any sense, but sometimes you got to let people know, that since I'm considered his Baltimore connect, what's going on the streets and why people are still dumb, deaf, and blind to showing up, huh? Because they have, where people don't have necessary access to different types of people, and so they run into these little neighborhood people, and they taking these pot shots at brothers that have been putting in the work, more serious work than many of these others. So, but the conversation was about the debate of the decade where Brother Malik alluded to the fact that he helped some LGBT person. I mean, not that it was politicized, you know, that the person came out and said, "Help me because I'm LGBT." It was just a brother looking for a job, or, you know, and Malik helped him, you know, just like he helps any other person that looks like you and I that need a job. So, you know, it's very interesting that, you know, you have these little narrow divisions, because sometimes, you know, that discrimination policies that individuals are attempting to enforce, it could come back to affect you and your bottom line and your family's future if you are going around necessarily, you know, because we work with different people in many different areas, if, you know, and do we or will we agree with everything? But economically speaking, sometimes, you know, just like we have to go to Asian stores or Indian stores or Caucasian stores, and other African stores, people that are light complexioned or people that live on the west side or east side, whatever other Willie Lynch type of thing you have going on in your mind, we are going to have to work with different people. So what Brother Malik mentioned was that he expressed, "Don't worry about," he mentioned the gentleman by name, the brother by name. So, because I believe that there are many people who are out here and they can't differentiate, and particularly amongst the hardline LGBT community that are coming, assuming that you know, it's like people want to push their agenda and they don't want to hear anything else. You know, they want to talk about this conversation because, you know, they're able to eat off of the political ideology, you know, so they're of being an activist advocate. They get points or some type of position for claiming that they're standing up or representing a particular cause. Hell, stand up for the environment. If you want to stand up for a particular cause, I mean, you know, all of us are dying on the planet. So, you know, so if you want to stand up in something for unity, but I bet you you'll find one person to say, you know, we don't need that vegan stuff. That's too many. That's a Caucasian thing, or that's something from the people from the East, or that's not American. You know, that's not black people eat meat, you know, and we need to fight the people that want to push this vegan lifestyle. And I haven't heard not one of them, you know, Daren Muhammad, David Johnson over the years, yeah, say anything about the diets and things of this nature. And so, you know, it's rather shallow of them to, you know, take this little pop shot. But I will speak again. And my question is, where have these individuals been? For instance, in Baltimore, several years ago, in the month of April, I had a campaign addressing the issue of LGBT homosexuality and you know, these other issues. And I, in the month of April, I had three speakers Brother Irte Genie, Kush the Black Unifier, and Mwali Mubarudi. I brought all three of them there in the month of April. Didn't have any help from any of these folks in Baltimore. Not a one of you showed the hell up. And now, some 5-6 years later, you want to pretend that you've taken some type of hard line just because you need friends and you want to have Irritated Genie as a friend, huh? And you want to just hang on to people because you've done thrown everybody under the bus. You've destroyed your relationship, destroyed your brands, calling everybody out, everybody wrong but you, huh? And I honestly say that you haven't even been around enough. You haven't even interacted enough with enough people. You've been encapsulated, Brother Darren, and many of these little limited followers, people that don't read as broadly and don't diversify and show up at different things, and they haven't earned the right, and you haven't earned the right, you know, to critique anything, you know, certainly about Brother Malik, huh? I mean, now, you know, of course, not to suggest that I agree with anything, but he laid it out. He said that the issue is not that important. So he doesn't have the crystal ball or the in-depthness of what I have gained over the years from working with and studying the work of Mwali Mubarudi. But I did bring them together at one time. I did bring Barudi together with Brother Kush, huh? And Brother Malik, so that persons can begin to have this conversation. And not because, look, again, you know, as I heard Brother Prada say, not all of us know everything. So if you are projecting this image of you know, righteousness, like you know something, because now maybe you've read Brother Genie's book. Now I know you haven't read Baruti's book, but you know, you just interviewed him and brought him to town years after, I might add, years after that I've brought him to Baltimore 3 or 4 times. So now you're becoming awakening about this, huh? One, you and the other brothers, the East Side brothers, never discussed this issue. When I brought it to you, I was the only one from Baltimore coming to D.C., coming to both the PKV lectures as well as Irritated Genius before the split and after the split. So I was the only one coming to get this more insightful analysis. I was the one reading the books, you know, while some of you were just showing up at lectures, huh? And this is why I had to branch off and, you know, go to all the, yes, I've been to all the lectures in Baltimore, but, you know, when something was going on down the road, I was there. You know, I sacrificed my money, sacrificed and contributed to many of these different people. So, you know, so when people, when I do something, and I was a big part of this debate of the decade, but I didn't need for none of these people that's on these radio programs who dumbing the masses of black people down in Baltimore. I don't need you to at this point any longer, because I'm more intelligent than that at this time. It's not a numbers game of how many followers you have. Nah, I have enough skills, knowledge, and abilities, and have the right direction to know how to maneuver myself, economically speaking, to maintain my viability without having the ignorant masses just showing up like zombies or not showing up based upon how they feel about somebody, because somebody told them and they're not able to think for themselves and they're not able to do for themselves. So I saw this years ago, for instance, when I resurrected Ashwaukwesi in Baltimore. Many individuals, Ashwaukwesi didn't come to Baltimore for 9 years. 9 years. Hmm? There was nobody that aware or conscious in 9 years in Baltimore to bring this man back to Baltimore, a man that travels all over the world. Hmm? And nobody in 9 years thought that, you know, to keep, to find, and he's a good, he had a good business relationship. But, you know, sometimes we let small people influence our, you know, decisions. And so I have to say that, you know, from bringing Brother Kwesi back to Baltimore and really resurrecting his career in Baltimore. And in fact, what I'll say is, at one time when I was doing that, I got more people to come out to support Ashwa Kwesi and his wife than anyone on the East Coast. Some people didn't take too kindly to that because they thought that I wasn't, you know, I didn't know him enough like everybody else. I don't need to be up under anybody like any kind of way. I run my own independent thing good enough. You know, I support leaders and always, you know, I'm encouraging to other individuals, certainly, and I have supported many of these people without question. But I don't, you know, have to try to jockey for position. You know, I mean, it's not that kind of thing, man. You know, all of us need to find ways to work in harmony and to create economic opportunity. But it's what is interesting and how people are so blind and not able to think for themselves. There were times when, you know, sometimes I would go to an event, I would tell people about something, and I'd be the only one to show up. And then I start realizing that some groups don't want people to go to some other groups. And I had to be like, man, I'm going to think for my damn self. If it's some knowledge, if it's a topic that I need and I know that it's good for our community, I'm going. So, and I want to say shout out to the brother Sankofa and Baba, his elder, I'm sorry, brother Dennis Asar and Brother Calvin and his Baba's father. But brother, at this time, it ain't about coming, you know, for me, I don't go to things to say, oh yeah, I'm gonna support this person, or, you know, I think about the strategicness of it. You know, are these people going somewhere? Are they doing something real? Do they have the knowledge? Do they have the capital, the experience? Or do they have the decent health? Can they read? Hell, you know, can they implement some things? So I that's where I go. So I say to the brothers at the Temple of New African Thought, don't, you know, ain't about me. It's about certain unique pieces to the puzzle that I'm a part of, without question, that I'm a part of. Hmm? And I ain't gonna let anybody attempt to tell me anything otherwise, you know, certainly at this time. And it was like that before, but, you know, the stock continues to increase. And you got to continue to reevaluate yourself and reinvent yourself, and you continue to step into your own divine future and destiny. Hmm? So with that being said, Brother Malik did say he would come he would come on the show with Daren Muhammad or David Johnson. So I say he didn't say call in. He said come into the studio. So I say if you all have, you know, he's a part of the government. He's a part of the Illuminati, the Boule, and whatever else, little plots and plans that that many people have laid out for him or suggested that he's a part of. Invite him on your show. Not you know, a phone call, but tell him this is why you are a part of the you know, you're taking government money, you're taking LGBT money, and you are part of the plot to destroy black people. So and brother laid it out last night. Like, ain't nobody's on the good guy list, the Negro list, or the this the good Negro that we want. So I say, if you don't have nothing good to say, brothers, don't say nothing. You know, just do your thing in your own little world and keep it moving. You don't have to try to create a boogeyman because you're not growing. And most of these different individuals, they're not growing, so they gotta try to jump on board some bandwagon. And you know, most of them do things tactically because they know that I'm rising. You see, and they can't. Many of y'all can't even understand to what level I have rose to. Huh? You're too encapsulated. You're too enslaved to understand just the moves that I've already made and what I have the potential of making. I'm absolutely unstoppable. That's right. I wrote the book on the bestseller. That's right. And more is coming. Just got a Langston Hughes Award. Yes, at Empowerment Temple. I don't give a damn what you think. Yes, I'll leverage it properly. And I don't care who doesn't like anything I have to say. Period. Because I know that I've done more work for the masses of black people than many of these people combined. I've given tens and thousands and hundreds of thousands of people opportunity to get unique knowledge. Even amongst Jeannie and Baruti, sold dozens of their books, dozens of their videos over the years, expanded them, you know, to where their voice can be heard on various shows over the years. So I'm saying that, you know, stop with the pettiness, and you all perpetrators that are clicking like because you weren't a part of it. You didn't make it happen. You so one-dimensional or small-minded that you can't ally with different people because they have this one disagreement. And let me just say this for the record. I've done the knowledge. And this is why, for instance, that I called in on Carl Nelson's show the other day when Dr. Wesley Muhammad was on. And I thanked him for clarifying his position. And no, I don't try to agree with the nation or try to get all up in there. I don't need nothing like that. You know, I'm an independent brother that got enough good things going on. If folk don't know, I can move amongst many different circles. I'm the most centered African Senate scholar out here. Centered, yes. C-E-N-T-E-R-E-D. Just like the book. I'm centered. Totally. Huh? That might be the right book. Part two. How the Success Scholar is the most centered African Senate scholar of this time. That's right. Most of you are in, you think you're centered. you think you're centered. But you ain't sent it to do anything strategically and empowering for our community and for our freedom. So I'm just going to say, that straight off the bat. And then before I close, I will say that, yes. Oh, just in terms of brother, you know, the Carl Nelson show and Dr. Wesley, I thanked him for clarifying his position. Now, I was a little before where I agreed in some extent with Genie and the African Bambaataa. And I did wonder why the Nation didn't show up, you know, in New York. Because if I personally, I mean, and not that I need to be have my hand in everything, or but, you know, I would have shown up. I would have shown up, and I would encourage my supporters and those that, that have, you know, I mean, this issue certainly, you know, the pedophilia, the child molestation. I've interviewed Dr. Patricia Newton on my show. So I understand how, for instance, many of those that are suffering in our community, as Dr. Patricia Newton says, that 90% of the people that's going to these emergency rooms have been sexually assaulted. So I understand the damage, and it doesn't take any deep studies. It doesn't take a social work degree. Huh? I've been to the Association of Black Psychologists Conference. So I understand the psychological damage that these issues affect us as a community. I read Baruti's book, and he knows I read it. Absolutely. And on his show, he was surprised that I actually read it. When I had him on my show, I actually talked about a deep chapter in his book, and he was shocked that I read that far in his book. Well, that's what I do. That's what serious scholars do. We don't run around party hopping and wasting time. We're studying. You know, we're putting everything. You know, we don't have time for all this other stuff. We're doing, you know, the right knowledge and the right research. And so, what I'll say at this particular time, and certainly, and you know, I can't expect for, you know, Brother Malik to have studied the work of Baruti, to have those deep, you know, understandings of this. But, you know, I did that, brought them together some years ago, you know, and that's where individuals have to have enough character, enough compassion, enough human interactive skills, enough emotional intelligence, enough to, as scholars, to be able to communicate. And most of these scholars, they're not reading different people's stuff. Many of them, peer review of different people's work. You know, many of them are in their own area of expertise, if you will. Like Dr. Broder said on Carl Nelson's show two nights ago, you know, we don't know everything. A brother called in, and yeah, well, maybe you should have Taj Tariq Bey on, or somebody else talking about the Moors, you know, and Broder just laid it out like, look, I'm not gonna tell you that I know all of history here, you know, no, can't. I mean, that's not humanly possible. I'm sitting here watching this documentary of the untold history of the United States by, let me grab it. I mean, this is informative. I mean, you know, so this got me in a global state of mind, the untold history of the United States. Got a white market copy, but Oliver Stone. So it's given an analysis of the different wars and everything. But let me, you know, just add on and finish my point about the Wesley Muhammad, because he clarified some things. And no, I thought, yes, well, the Nation for some reason didn't have the pulse of the people on the Bambaataa issue. So yeah. So somebody up in New York, Malcolm X, you know, Moss, they weren't connected enough, or they didn't care enough to take a position on Bambaataa. Hmm? So that's where part of that discussion happened with, you know, the NOI. I mean, it's been going on for some time, but that's where I chose, because I thought that, okay, yeah, I'm gonna shine some light on this. I'm gonna shine some light on, just like some light should have been shined on Dr. York. Now, you have David Johnson, Hebrew, Daren Muhammad, and H.A. Genie. None of these folk have really dug into the biggest pedophile alleged, but from what I believe, if he wasn't, he was close to being that. He was close. You know, I'm just gonna say I wasn't there, but a few people that were there, they hold fast to what they say, you know, and I talk to them, you know, so I'm saying they have no reason to lie to me. They have no, what do they have to gain in a one-on-one conversation? And I'm not going on a witch hunt for Dr. York. I got more important things to do, but I believe that since that how can somebody, these damn cults out here, and that's another thing, stay away from these damn cults. These Afrocentric cults, these drum-beating cults, these folk will suck your ass dry. You won't have a damn thing to show for nothing, like I almost did not have a damn thing to show for anything. And now I had to change gears, man. You know, I had to change gears. And so now, you know, I'm going to raise these things up over the next few weeks and months. You know, I'm going to shift gears, you know, on my knowledge and the diversity that I've had and the books that I've read. I've read enough, straight up. I've read enough to get to where I need to go. Of course, there's some small things I got to, you know, always retrain myself, reinvent myself, but I'm good. I'm an independent, you know, success scholar. And I'm teaching for empowerment. So, yeah, so Brother Wesley, I think he clarified his position. You know, and I wanted people to know, like, look, I'm not nobody to hold a scholar, a brother, you know, to that previous, you know, 10-year, what you did 10 years ago. I had a silly somebody say something stupid to me. I'm like, man, just get off my damn page, man. You're just talking about something 10 years, 8 or 9 years ago. You damn bum. You know, damn crazy lowlife. So, yeah, so that's what I have to say about Daren Muhammad. Can't shine the shoes of Brother Malik Zulu Shabazz. And I must say again that I know Brother Irte Genie may feel a certain way about Malik just mentioning his name, and he wants to get people riled up about it. Get people riled up about it, and so that you can diss the whole event. But you know, look, you're entitled to. But as Brother Malik, he has bigger goals. You know, he has more important things, and you know that's where you want to stay. Talking about, you know, being a one-hit wonder, a one-hit scholar, a one-topic scholar. You know, then that's where you can stay. But as long as Brother Malik got people like me around that have touched enough on these topics. And no, I don't necessarily pretend that I've dug that deep, and that's why I have to, you know, say that I have a better plan for black people than all of these leaders, because I didn't stay in these areas. I mean, it's good to know, and you know, it's strategic times to address it, like the Bambaataa case. It was strategic for me to address it, and it should have been strategic for the nation to address it. But are you going around marching around every day, all day, talking about pedophilia pedophilia must go? Are you marching around every day? No, because most of us are working. Those of us that have bills, and hopefully if we have children, we're working somewhere every day. And if you think that you're going to get paid to build the pedophilia million movement when it's it or the anti-homosexual movement when it's only affecting a small percentage of the people. Now, some people, they are emotionally damaged where they may have to deal with it and heal themselves. And I hope that that there's that conversation between these people. But if that's the case, become a therapist, you know, become a therapist and to treat the people, you know, properly, to heal, have them talk out their emotional issues and have them overcome these issues. And so my goal as the success scholar, of course, is to move people beyond their limitations of their thoughts, their limitations of their pain, the limitations of their childhood drama. And you do that through work and study and beginning to heal yourself to know that if certain things weren't your fault. You know, if you are molested and raped, you know, many people have various levels of denial, the eight stages. I can't recall the eight stages of I don't know if it's called stress or, but, you know, there are different stages that people go through when grieving. I'm sorry, it's a grieving process, if I'm not mistaken. So we need these teachable moments. In various professions, it's called teachable moments to be present. For instance, when people have these issues, and right now, for instance, people are experiencing these sexual confusions through the prison system. So we have to be ready to address that. And this is why films like 13th, which I just saw like 2-3 days ago, why those are critical in the book that Michelle Alexander are promoting. And you have people like Daren Muhammad that want to castigate her. And, you know, man, just like, hey, man, stop it. Stop being a conspiracy theorist. Everything a damn number. Everything a damn spooky. Oh, yeah. Look at them. They are part of the plot. They are part of the LBGTQ plot. No, man, people don't have time to be thinking about these things. And if you think that it's the most important thing, no, it's not the most important thing to everybody. No. People are doing practical things more than Irritate Genie is doing. Brother Malik is employing black people. How many people are you employing? Huh? Straight up, keeping people from dying. Dying right there on the job or dying trying to feed themselves. That's what warriors and generals do. Straight up. They not sitting around and, you know, they worrying about, yes, got these many people to feed. These are the numbers. This is how much I need to make to feed employees. See, this is a different mindset from a mindset where you got time to be worried about every other little minute detail. So I'm saying that, no, Malik don't have time for that. He got a child to feed, bills to pay, a payroll. You know, he don't have time, you know, he don't have time for all the intellectual masturbation and the community talks and people who want to be on radio and talk about every damn body, everybody wrong, and dissing people and fighting. That's what some of you people want to do. So I'm saying that real adults and real nation builders move differently. So I'm saying for you all that want to be, remain ignorant, remain shallow. Yes, and you can study these people. And look, I've gone to 90, 80% of the brother's lectures, and I have all of his DVDs. So I'm not saying that you know, you can't learn from the brother, but, you know, just stop with the antics. The antics trying to diss other people and you know, creating these different disagreements. So I just want to say that, and I'll close. I know this is quite long, but, you know, it just pissed me off. I mean, you know, folk, what's this, these people, they never want to say my name, and you know, they know I'm making moves, and you know, they know I'm conscious, super conscious. I know every day. I ain't gonna say everything, but you know, I've been to many of these different lectures, and you know, over the years, I read all the right books, the most relevant books, and you know, instead of you know, trying to find some level of atonement, they just wanna be haters. You know, they just wanna be haters. They wanna diss the whole event so that if some people be like, oh yeah, Brother Haki was there, they can say, oh yeah, well that Malik is he doing this, or that Cornel West. So that's a little sly way to attempt to stop the rise of the success scholar. So here's the thing. You can't stop what I've already built. All right. You know, it's not even a question. So there are some, you know, we have my crew has the smartest, most empowered people, black people right now on the planet. And I'm the most centered. And so I say for you all that want to be real and you desire to move forward, stay connected to the rise of the success scholar. We definitely making the right connections and doing the right things and showing up at the right places. And so that's all I have to say. So keep hollering. Stay connected. I got a show tonight. Check me out. Until later. Peace.